Today, in matters of fact, intervention by President Duterte supposedly settled finally the bitter row among three of his supporters over the speakership in the 18th Congress. Under a term-sharing deal struck by the president, Congressman Alan Peter Cayetano will serve for the first 15 months, followed by Congressman Lord Alan Velasco for the next 21. The third contender, Congressman Martin Romualdez, will hold the powerful position of majority leader. But what happens now to the committee chairmanships, which are just as contested as the chamber's top post? Joining us today is Representative Michael Defensor, a former Quezon City congressman and member of former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo's cabinet. He's back in Congress as representative of Anakalusugan, a part of this group advocating for health care reforms. Good morning, Congressman. Thank you for
joining
us.
Good morning, Christian. Good morning. Good morning to everyone.
And welcome back to the House of Representatives.
Thank you.
Okay, let's talk about the speakership race. Supposedly, the president has already settled the row, but is it actually over? Are we not expecting any more surprises on Sona Day on Monday?
Well, because even before, when we were asking the president to make a to announce who his candidate is for the speakership, the three camps have already accepted the announcement of the president that it would be Speaker Alan Cayetano, and that after 15 months, it will be Congressman Lord Velasco. Now, of course, as a stabilizing force, there were so many questions about term sharing and the change of leadership. Congressman Martin Romualdez will be serving the entire term of 3 years as majority floor leader. Okay. So yes, it's accepted, and everyone now is helping out in the organization of the House.
There will be no coup on Monday?
I don't think so. I don't think there will be a coup. I think everyone respects the pronouncement of the president. And that, as we're talking now, since last week, they have been fixing the organization of the House. Christian, on the 22nd of July, the election of the leadership of the House will not only be for the speakership. It will be for the deputy speakers, 14 of them, and the majority floor leader. In fact, the process would be that the Secretary General would appoint and designate an acting majority floor leader, and I'm assumed that it would be Congressman Martin Romualdez, and then after which a speaker will be elected. So the chairmanships initially would not be, I would think it would not be settled before the 22nd, but the deputy speaker should be settled because that is the mandate of the rules of the House when we open on the 22nd of July.
But of course, that's the other complication, the chairmanships. Perhaps
yes.
Even more complicated than the race for the speakership. My question is, what happens to the commitments made by the other contenders for House Speaker now that it's Alan Peter Cayetano, who was chosen by the president?
Well, I'm not sure about the other camps, but
For Martin Romualdez.
Yeah, for Congressman Martin Romualdez, of course, when he met with the group and thanked everyone, his statement was, I'll try to help everyone get the positions they aspire for. Of course, he's not speaker, and that it is, he hopes that he would be able to substantially comply with the request of the congressman. And I think most of them, because, you know, there's a big bulk of first-termers, about 100. Mm-hmm. For the first-termers come backing, it would number about 130, so total about 130. So you only have a very small group of third-termers. Mm-hmm. So I don't think it would be a complication for them to have committee chairmanships or senior vice chairmanships.
So in your case, you're not considered as a neophyte, you're a returning congressman?
Yes, yes.
So are you expected to hold a chairmanship?
Well, Christian, in my case, even when I was talking with Congressman Martin Romualdez and with the camp of Congressman Alan Peter Cayetano, I did not ask for any position. I just told them, you know, where they see I could function best to help in the legislative agenda. And of course, health, it would be a main advocacy on my part. So that was my only request. I didn't ask for any particular position like the others.
But so far, what are the contentious issues when it comes to the settlement of the chairmanships? For example, committees like appropriations?
Yes.
Are they settled already?
Accounts? I would think so. Well, in the case of accounts, it would always be the choice of the speaker,
yeah,
because that is the funds of Congress. In the case of appropriations, Congressman Ungab has been there before,
yeah,
and I think he's highly respected by many of our colleagues. So I would think he would be maintained as chairman of the Committee on Appropriations. The debate, or if there would be any problem, I would think would be on the HRET, the constitutional mandated positions, the Commission on Appointments, and so on and so forth.
So ito yung mga contentious issues, HRET and CA. How about justice?
Justice...
Who are actually, who are vying for that chairmanship?
I'm not really aware, but, you know, I think there are a lot of lawyers. Fred Castro, of course, our majority, the 17th Congress Majority Floor Leader, is recognized also as a very good lawyer and the one who can handle the Committee on Justice. Mm. But, you know, Christian, I think what's critical is the constitutional amendments.
Yeah.
Because as pronounced by the President and many of our leaders in Congress, both Senate and in the House, now is really the time if there would be amendments in the Constitution. So you would have a, you should have a very strong chairman on constitutional amendments, constitutional reforms.
So who are the options?
I'm not really aware of who are vying and who would be the choice of the speaker.
Mm. How about the minority leader? Because there's always this complaint that if you're all wrangling for that position of speaker and other committee chairmanships, why not give once and for all the minority post to the real opposition?
Well, it would depend on, because the rules state very clearly, the one with the second highest majority vote would be the minority floor leader. In the past, when I was in the minority, it was very clear, you know, the majority were talking amongst themselves and the minority were talking amongst themselves.
Then head-to-head during the election for speaker.
Head-to-head, and more or less even before the elections, we already knew who would be from the opposition and who would be with the majority. Now, in the recent times, the rules state that the second highest, so it could be still with the majority, but would have the second highest vote. So I do not know how that would be settled.
So what are we seeing in terms of a situation or scenario on Monday? Of course, Alan Peter Cayetano would be nominated.
Yes.
Are we expecting another member of the majority to actually contest the speakership so that he would end up serving as minority?
I would think so. But to be fair to Congress, even during our time, you know, if you consider the opposition, then you would have the left-leaning groups.
The progressives.
The progressive groups. Even during our time, it wasn't like that. No, there were the so-called independent or part of the minority, but independent minority. That time, it was the Lakas, who was the minority. Now, in the present case, you have now, I think, Congressman Sarate declared for speakership. I don't know how many votes he would get. So that would have to be settled amongst those who would want to be part of the minority group. But definitely, Congressman Sarate running for speakership would be part of the minority.
Because you're also hearing the name of Congressman Fred Castro.
Yes.
Who is supposedly interested in the position of minority leader.
Yes.
Is that true?
Well, because now he is out of the majority, many people feel that Congressman Fred Castro would be an effective minority floor leader. You know, Fred Castro's performance as majority floor leader is well respected, highly commendable. And, you know, if you have a combination of a strong minority under his leadership, that I think would also be good for the legislative agenda of the president.
But wouldn't that be weird because he is identified with Ferdinand Martin Romualdez? Romualdez will serve as the majority leader. So basically, you have the Romualdez group controlling both the majority floor leader's position and the minority floor leader's position.
I think outside of the names or outside of the labels, it's our performance that would matter. In the case of the minority before, when I was with the minority, you know, part of our role is to really be active in the debates. You know, to be. Debating on legislation, to be debating on the national consensus on the issues that confront Congress and that confront the nation. So very critical would be the role of the minority in terms of their participation in legislation. It doesn't mean that if you're part of the minority, you know, you won't be able to or you shouldn't be supporting the president or supporting the administration. What is critical is your role to fiscalize in terms of budget, in terms of legislation, and in terms of national debate.
But if you give that to someone who actually belonged or still part of the majority, so there are opportunities that should be given to the real opposition that won't be given to them because the position is held by someone identified with the administration.
Well, if you go into that to that debate, in the case of the Liberal Party, even before the speakership, they already said, we want to be part of the majority. So are they the real opposition? If they become minority, I don't know. But, you know, I respect that. If they want to be part of the majority, that's fine with me. If they want to be part of the minority, would that be the real opposition? I really do not know. For me, what's important is your role in Congress, your how you're able, you know, if you're minority, you have to be talking. You have to fiscalize. When the budget is presented, you have to look into the different provisions of the budget and debate on the budget. Sometimes it's even harder to be part of the majority because when you're part of the majority, the tendency is to tell you to be quiet because you're part of the majority.
You toe the line.
Yeah, and you toe the line. So from my experience, I've seen it, and you know, it's not really being black and white. But to be minority, I think you have more room to debate and to discuss legislation and the positions in the national consensus.
Now, this coalition established by President Duterte, how would you describe this? Because some people might tend to see that as an unsteady coalition. You have alpha males all over the place.
Yes.
Alan Peter Cayetano, Velasco, and of course Romualdez. Do you think this would hold, this arrangement?
Alam mo, Cristiano, when I was asked, sabi nila, oh Mike, veterano ka na, marami ka na pinagdaanan, alam mo yung nangyari. Sabi ko, parang sundalo yan eh. Yung sundalo, lumaban sa Korean War, lumaban sa Vietnam War. Ito, puro zombie yung kalaban. You don't know how to strategize, you don't know how to fight. So you're correct, you know, you're as confused as I am. But the bottom line is, you have a very strong support for the president. In the next 3 years, people are saying, you know, we have to give him the legacy that he wants to accomplish. We want to strengthen the economy. We want to strengthen the armed forces. You know, recently the president spoke about terrorism and, you know, his worry about the intelligence reports that he's getting.
Yeah.
So what you have now is a situation where you have a very strong president that everyone wants to support. You know, and I think that in itself would hold the coalition.
But you also have a very strong daughter of the president.
Yes.
Well, how do you think that would factor in?
In the same manner, Mayor Inday has been very, you know, vocal about us supporting the president and pushing for the legislative agenda. Even when she was talking about term sharing, her main concern was that there should be continuity in approving the agenda of the president, in approving the laws that is required by the administration. So, even if there are, you know, you have a very strong personality under with Inday Sara, the president, you have the cabinet. Of course, Congressman Pulong Duterte would be in Congress. While there are, you know, in the speakership, there were partisan debates. Once this is over, I think all of us will unite in passing the needed or the required laws of the president.
You don't see any more movement coming from the other members of the Duterte coalition because of what happened?
As of now, you know, everything has been quiet. We are all working. Right after the announcement of the president, Congressman Martin met with us. We met with Speaker Alan Cayetano. Speaker Alan Cayetano, you know, spoke about unity and how we can best support the president. And as we are talking now, on a daily basis, they are working on the organization of the House.
But you also get the impression that he's there simply because the president said that it's Cayetano who should be the speaker for the first 15 months. But does he actually hold control over his peers among yourselves?
When the three groups, particularly the leaders, you know, the candidates for speakership, asked the president on who should be Speaker of the House, they all agreed that whatever will be the pronouncement of the president, they will respect and they will support. So even now, the different camps are, you know, in a fight. You're all working together. You're all strategizing. But after that, that is now the partisan part. The non-partisan part would be our respective districts, our respective advocacies. Like in my case, I asked them that I be given a chance and a space in the Committee on Health, in the oversight of PhilHealth, because that is part of the campaign promise that we gave during the campaign. So, yes, there are different camps when we started out, but now we're united. as one Congress.
But can they actually work together? How's the working relationship between Cayetano and Romualdez, and then later on, Velasco and Romualdez?
First, let me settle about the Cayetano-Romualdez coordination. I think it's there. They're working together. They're fixing the organization of the House. Congressman Romualdez, as majority floor leader, has to push the legislation required, the first of which will be the budget to be submitted by the President on the 22nd of July. Yes. So it's very critical that we give Congress a chance to deliberate the budget and to pass it as soon as possible. So that's very critical, given or having in mind the direction of the President, strengthening the military, the requirements of
infrastructure,
the build program, which is very, very critical in the next 3 years. So that would be the role of Congressman Martin Romualdez. I would think Speaker Alan Cayetano would be able to not only utilize Congressman Martin Romualdez, but all of us, the different committee chairmen, the deputy speakers, in order to make the function of the House most efficient and effective for legislation and for the country.
Now, how about the party's coalition? Because before, there was the impression that Congressman Mikey Romero was trying to unify the entire bloc, but it seems that you guys are also divided, fragmented.
To be fair to the bloc, when we had the debates before, we agreed that this is just the partisan part. Now, what is critical for the party-less coalition is the constitutional mandate of having 20%, because that was the mandate of the Constitution. The party-less should be 20% of the total number of Congress. And so the assertion is that in the positions to be given, whether you're minority or majority, that if the 20% should be reflected.
Will that be reflected under Cayetano's speakership?
I would think so, and I should think so, because
may commitment na?
Meron na sila mga pinag-uusapan na positions. Mm. But I would think that that should be a respected, not only mandate of the Constitution, but more or less a modus vivendi in the leadership and the party-less bloc. Because, you know, while we are divided during the speakership, you know, we had our respective candidates.
Yeah.
Now that it's over, then the party-less bloc is united in terms of how do we get the budget for our respective programs? How do we get our legislation passed? And the party-less bloc is organized and solid in that regard.
So we're back to being solid after the leadership row was settled by the President.
Yeah, well, Chris, you have to understand, you know, it's many of them, when they were working Congress, you know, there were friendships here and there. Mm. I would think Congressman Lord Velasco was close to some of us. Mm. Some of us were close to Congressman Martin Romualdez and Alan Peter Cayetano. So the partisan part is understandable, and we agreed on that. Mm. But in terms of how the party list would be treated, that we are solid. Because for me, even if, for example, assuming, for example, ex-congressman in the party list supported a different person, but if he's not given what is due him in terms of committee position, in terms of budget, then I would be out in support of that person, of the a member of the party list.
Now, finally, you had this well-publicized spat with Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte.
Yes.
How's your relationship now? Were you able to bury the hatchet?
Well, Christian, first, I made an apology, public apology, to Mayor Inday Sara.
Did she accept it?
And I'm doing it again now, Mayor Inday. If I offended you in any way, I apologize for that. And then I was able to text her personally to apologize. And yes, she told me that, in fact, she thanked me for apologizing, and that if there's anything to clarify or to verify, for me to contact her directly. And I appreciate Mayor Inday for
course,
that.
Of course, this started because of that text message that supposedly came from Sara Duterte.
No, actually,
supposedly.
Supposedly. But what happened was when I showed it, I didn't see that there was a quote-unquote Mayor Inday. So it was unfair that, you know, it sounded, or if you read it, it would seem that it really came from her.
That she was campaigning against Alan Peter Cayetano, even if Cayetano was already picked by the President?
I'm not sure about the exact
the impression. Ganun yung impression.
Yeah, but what I mentioned was, because that afternoon we had a meeting, and there were two congressmen who were talking about the Duterte coalition, And I said, you know, there's a text message, because it was during the farewell dinner of President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo, and there was another person who received the same text. So I was just mentioning it, but when I showed the text, I didn't know that there was a name. So I apologized immediately for that.
So hindi niyo technically kinalat? Kumbaga, you just showed it to someone else?
No, I actually showed it to media.
That's a problem.
Yeah, and if it was just a text without her name, I think that would have been fine, because I was just saying that there's a text going around. But since the name was there, it was wrong of me to involve her in the speakership fight.
But all's well now between you and Mayor Sara Duterte?
Yes, I would think so. I apologized to her directly and she replied to me. By the way,
before I let you go, regarding this charter change, because the president already acknowledged that it might be difficult to shift to federalism, but he was pushing you guys to actually amend the constitution.
Yes.
So how are you expected to deliver at least during the first 15 months? Because they say that's crucial.
Christian, the United States Constitution has been amended so many times, more than 100 times, I think 140 plus times. I mean 140 plus times. I'm not sure about the number. But they have done it quietly, without fuss, without the confusion that we have now. In the case of the Constitution, when I was in Congress in the past, I was opposed to it, because that was 1987, I was elected 1995. So I was saying it's a very young constitution.
But now it's more than 30 years.
More than 30 years, and there are, if it is not a complete revision of the constitution, there are parts of the constitution that we really have to amend.
Okay.
So I believe that we can do it with the help of the Senate. And if we particularly say this would be the amendments, then I think we will be able to amend the Constitution.
Okay, Congressman Mike Defensor, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you for watching. Now, for more videos, subscribe to the official ANC YouTube channel and click the I button.